हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द वीडियो लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ क्रिप्टोग्राफिक नेटवर्क सिक्योरिटी। आई एम योर इंस्ट्रक्टर डॉक्टर रमेश प्रजापति एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न द ब्लॉक साइफर मोड ऑफ ऑपरेशन। सो लेट्स सी द एजेंडा ऑफ दिस वीडियो लेक्चर। द फर्स्ट इलेक्ट्रॉनिक कोड बुक ईसीबी साइफर ब्लॉक चेनिंग एंड द लास्ट इज अ साइफर फीडबैक मोड। सो लेट्स सी the block cipher mode of operation. So before going to start the block cipher mode of operation, let's see now. As we have known, the encryption can be done in a two phases. The first stream cipher and second is a block cipher. So the stream cipher, it means the message can be processed, message should be processed or message should be represented in the bit. Now the block cipher, the message should be represented in the block. It means that in the stream cipher, the bit by bit operation will be carried out. It means that if I want to perform the encryption and decryption, then encryption will be carried out in the bit. Now in the stream cipher we are considering the 8 bit. It means in the stream cipher we are considering the bit by bit operation. It means first we are considering the first bit of plain text and the first bit of key. Now we are performing the XOR operation. After performing the XOR operation, then generating the result. Same for selecting the, now we are selecting the second bit of plain text and the second bit of key. Applying the XOR operation, after that generating the result. So here we are performing a bit by bit operation. But in a block cipher, we are performing a block by block operation. Now in a block cipher, the block message, plain text message divided into a fixed number of block, and each and every block we are performing a encryption and the decryption. Now in a block cipher, what is the size of the block? So the size of the block is totally depend on algorithm which we are going to use, and there are different types of algorithms are there. How we are converting the plain text into the cipher text? So there are various modes to process the plain text into the cipher text. So let's see. Now we already discussed total 5 modes of operation. Now there are 5 modes of operation have been defined. The first, electronic code book, cipher block chaining, cipher feedback mode, output feedback, and the counter. Now this all modes are intended to use with the symmetric block cipher. Symmetric block cipher, it means one key is used for the encryption and the decryption, and this same key is also with a single key or the secret key, and the secret key will be shared between the two users or two parties, and this is included in the DNS data encryption standard and the advanced encryption standard. Now let's see the first, what is block cipher? We already discussed, right? The block cipher is operate on a fixed length b bit input to produce the b bit cipher text. Now how, if your plain text is longer than the b bit, how you can perform the encryption? So first, the plain text message, if your plain text message is longer than the b bit, so now break the plain text into the b bit block, break the plain text into a bit block and apply the cipher on each block. Now sometimes we need a padding, if sometimes we need a extra bit to make a same block at that time, we should add the padding. It means that if we are considering the name field is a 10 character, the name is a one field and it's the 10 character size. Now it would be RAM, the name field would be RAM. Now if I want to make the 10 characters field, so now we have to add a extra bit. So here if I want to make a 10 bit character, so here RAM, then after I am adding the 000000, it means the total size is 10 characters. So zeros is represent the parent character. Sometimes we have required this paid over here, right? So let's see another scenario. If your plain text size is a 185 bit, your plain text size is a 185 bit and the block size is 64 bit, so you have to divide the 125 into the 64 bit. So 64 bit block, that means the 64 bit and the last is a 56 bit block. First block it can be processed in 64 bit. Second block it also process, it can process 64 bit. Now the last block is a 56 bit. So now if we make the 56 bit into the 64 bit, so we have to add extra bit. So here we add 8 bit into the 56 bit. We adding the 8 bit into the 56 bit. So now you will get the 64 bit. So this extra bit, we added extra bit. This is called the padding. Now let's see the first block of operation, electronic code boom. Now here the plain text is handled one block at a time and each block of plain text is encrypted using the same key. So here, now here we are considering the plain text block, and the plain text block is divided into the fixed number of block and each block is processed at a time. So here each block of plain text is encrypted using the same key. Here we are using the same key for encryption and the decryption. Now here code book is used because the given key, there is a unique cipher text for every bit, B bit block of plain text. It means that if we use here, we use the code book. It means that now here we applying the encryption along with the key on the plain text block, it generating a different ciphertext block. It means that the number of ciphertext block to be not revealed. Now here the formula or mathematical formula to convert your plain text block into the ciphertext. So here you can see the first block of ciphertext CJ. J is starting the 1, 2, 3 up to 7, and now we applying the encryption on a plain text block attributing the PJ along with the key. Now it generating the first block of ciphertext. PJ, P represents the plain text block, J start from 1, 2 up to 7, N. Now, same, if I want to convert ciphertext block into the plain text message, so again there is one notation or one formula, mathematical notation. PJ represent the ciphertext or plain text block, and J is start from 1, 2 up to 7, N. It means that the PJ equal to 1, it means that this is the first block P1. Now again we apply the decryption on the ciphertext block, first block of ciphertext block along with the key. After applying the decryption, it generating the first block of plain text. So now let's see the diagram. So here you can see we have divided our now. The plain text block is divided into the fixed size block and the block size is 64 bit, and it represents the P1, first block of plain text, P2, second block of plain text, and the up to 7 PA. Now here we are applying the encryption. So here now we applying the encryption along with the key on the first block of plain text message. Now it generating a ciphertext, it means the first block of cipher. Now same for P2, same for PA. Now here this process will be carried out in a parallel. It means that at the same time the multiple block will be encrypted. After encrypted, it's generating the number of ciphertext block. So this process will be carried out in a parallel. It means at the same time we are performing a multiple operation at the same time. We are doing multiple operation at the same time. It means that here the multiple plain text block will be encrypted at the same time. After applying the encryption, it's generating the ciphertext block at the same time. And here the size of the plaintext block is 64 bits. Now it should generate the ciphertext and its size is 64 bits. It means that the size of the plaintext block is equal to the size of the ciphertext block. Now same for decryption. If I want to convert my ciphertext into the plaintext message, it means that I want to retrieve the original message. So here again we put this reverse process. It means this ciphertext block C1, C2 up to C1, CN. Now we apply the decryption along with the key on the ciphertext block. After applying the decryption, it is generating the first block of plaintext message. Now here it is very simple, right? This message is very simple because we applying the encryption along with the key on the plaintext message, and after applying the encryption it is generating the original message or plaintext message. So it is very simple. Now but there is one limitation over here. It means the problem, it if your message is very long, so in that, in your message there's some repetition of plaintext block will be there. So after applying the encryption, it's generating the repetition block of ciphertext. So this is the one limitation. So based on this repetition of plaintext in the ciphertext, attacker will capture your message or attacker will try to capture your key based on this repetition of plaintext in the ciphertext. So here when we use this application, in if your message is very short, then if you want to send the sort of message to the receiver side, at that time we should use this application, and it is a temporary encryption key. Secure transmission of the sort piece of information, means your message is very short, then this message is feasible. This method is feasible. This mode is feasible. Now the second cipher block chaining CBC, we overcome this limitation. We will use the second technique, cipher block chaining, that is for the CBC. In the CBC, and also the block cipher mode. Now here, if your plaintext block is same and or the plaintext block is repeated, it produces the different ciphertext block. It means that if the some repetition of the plaintext block will be there, we applying the encryption. After applying the encryption, it generating a different ciphertext block. So here we are using the initialization variable. Here again we are using the same key is used for the each block. It means that if the same key is used for the encryption and the decryption. Now here we are using initialization vector. Initialization vector, it represent the random number or random value, and it should be kept secret from the attacker. And here this initialization vector must be known by the sender to the receiver, and it must be kept secret from the attacker, because once the initialization vector known by the attacker, then it capture your key. It will be able to capture your key. So that's why it should be kept secret from the attacker. Now here one formula or one mathematical notation to convert your plaintext into the ciphertext. So let's see the first block. If I want to convert my first block of plaintext into the ciphertext, so one formula is C1 equal to C1. It is the first block of ciphertext. That means first of all we applying the XOR operation on the initialization vector with the first block of plaintext. After applying the XOR operation, it's generating a result. Now we applying the encryption along with the key on the previous result. We applying the encryption along with the key on the previous result generated after the calculation of XOR operation. Now this is called the first block. It means that we applying the, it means after applying the XOR operation, it generating the result. On that result, we applying the encryption along with the key After applying the encryption, it's generating a first block of ciphertext. Now, if I want to generate the second block of ciphertext, it means that here CJ, it means that after generating a first block of ciphertext, we will process next block of plain text. So here CJ, series start from the 2, 3 up to 7. Why start from the 2? We will see in the next slide. Now we applying the encryption. Now we are applying the XOR operation on the first block of plain text PJ and the CJ minus 1. CJ, it means the 2 minus 1, it means it remains the first block of ciphertext. CJ minus 1, it means the J equal to 2. So 2 minus 1, it remains the C1 block. Now PJ start from the P2. It means that now we are processing the second block of plain text. So here we apply the XOR operation on the CJ minus 1 with the PJ. After applying the XOR operation, it is generating the result. Now on that result, we apply the encryption along with the key. Now it is generating the second block of ciphertext. Same. If I want to convert my ciphertext into the plaintext message, so here the P1 is the first block of plaintext. Now we are applying the decryption on the ciphertext, first ciphertext block along with the key. After applying the decryption, it is generating the result. On that result, we apply the XOR operation with the initialization vector. After applying this XOR, it is generating the first block of plaintext message. Now same thing, if I want to generate the second block of plain text. So here again your J start from the 2, 3 up to 7, n. Here first we are applying the encryption, first we are applying the decryption on a CJ along with the key. After applying the encryption, that means first we are applying the encryption on a CJ along with the key. After applying the encryption, it's generating a result. On that result, we apply the XOR operation with the CJ minus 1. So now you will get the second block of plain text messages. So let's see in the diagram how to generate or how to convert the plain text into the ciphertext. So let's see the plain text block P1, it means the plain text message divided into fixed number of block. And the block is P1, P2 up to PN. Now first we applying the XOR operation on a first block of plain text P1 along with the initialization vector. And initialization vector, it is determining the random number. It means it generating a random number or a random value. Now after applying the XOR operation, it's generating a some result. Now, after applying the encryption, it's generating a first block of ciphertext. Now we are presenting the next plain text block. Now, the next plain text block P2. Now, the output of the first block, output of the first plain text block C1, will be given input to the second block of plain text. You can see the output of the first block of plain text C1. Will be given input to the second block of plain text P2. Now we apply the XOR operation on a P2 and the C1 which was generated from the previous block. After applying the XOR operation, it's generating a result. Now again applying the encryption along with the key on the previous result which was generated from the XOR operation. After applying the encryption, it's generating the second block of plain text, second block of ciphertext. Now, we'll repeat this process until the final block PN will be converted into the final block of ciphertext CN. Now, this is the plain text message converted into the ciphertext. Now, we'll do the reverse process. If I want to decrypt the message, so there is a again. We are considering the C1, C2, up to CN, C1, C2, CN, ciphertext block, applying the decryption along with the key. After that, it generated some result. On that result, we apply the XOR operation along with the resolution vector. After that, it generating a first block of print expenses. Now, here, now we will process the second block of ciphertext. Apply the decryption along with the key on the ciphertext C2 block. After applying the decryption, it's generating a some result. After applying the decryption, it's generating a some result. On that result, we apply the XOR operation along with the first block of ciphertext. After applying XOR operation, it's generating a second block of plaintext messages, P2. Now, repeat this process until the final ciphertext block CN will be converted into the PN. So, this is all about the CBC. Why it is called the CBC, cipher block chaining? Because here, the output of the first block will be given input to the second block. Same, the output of the second block will be given input to the next block. That's why it is called the cipher block chaining. Now, here, the what is the strength of this CBC? The CBC is an encrypt, is an appropriate mode for encrypting a message of the length greater than DB. It means that if your message is very longer than DB, then it is appropriate mechanism. Now, where we use this application, the general purpose block oriented transmission. It means where we require the block oriented transmission, at that time we should use this method. And now the authentication, it means if I want to perform the authentication, at that time we should use this CBC cipher block chaining. Now in the hashing function, we will use this technique or mode of operation to achieve the authentication between different parties. Now the next is a cipher feedback mode. Now next technique is called the cipher feedback mode. So let's see here the convert the block cipher into the stream cipher using the cipher feedback mode, output feedback mode and the counter mode. It means that now not every application will be work on a block cipher. The sum of the technique will be available and that technique will be work on a stream cipher, in a stream cipher mode. So that's why we require the stream cipher mode. So here the remaining three technique, cipher feedback, output feedback and the counter mode will be work on a stream cipher mode. That means we will perform the bit by bit encryption and the decryption. Now the stream cipher is eliminate the need to paid a message. It means that here when we use the stream cipher mode, so at that time we don't require the padding. We don't require the padding of extra bit because here we are performing the bit by bit operation and here the size of the bit is 8 bit. So we don't require the padding. Now, so here we have required the one shift register because initially we don't consider shift register. Because why we require shift register? Because we want to perform the left sync operation. So that's why we need a B bit shift register. Now here leftmost bit of S bit, it means that here the input to encryption function is a B bit shift register that initially set to some initialization vector. That means that here initially we don't consider the B bit shift register. Instead of B bit shift register, we should consider the initialization vector. Now here the leftmost S bit of the output of the encryption function are XOR with the first segment of the plaintext P1 to produce the first unit of ciphertext C1, which is then transmitted. So let's see how this this mode is work. So let's see here. Content of the shift register is shifted left by S bit and C1 is placed in the rightmost S bit of the shift register. Now for decryption, the same scheme is used. accept the received ciphertext until the XOR with the output of the encryption function to produce the plain text. Now we will see how this cipher feedback mode is work. So let's see in the diagram. First, we are considering the encryption. That means here we are considering the initialization vector. We already discussed that instead of sync register, we will use initialization vector at the first time. Now we apply the encryption along with the key on the initialization vector. After applying the encryption, it generates the 64-bit output. It means the initialized size of the initialization vector is also 64-bit. Now, after applying the encryption, it generating a 64-bit output. Now, in this 64-bit, we select the S bit. We select the S bit, and remaining bit will be discarded. That means that the equation is B minus S bit. It means B bit is the total 64-bit. Out of 64-bit, we select the S bit. S bit is doing the 8-bit. It means here we considering the 8-bit, because I already told you when we perform the stream cipher operation, so at that time we should use the 8-bit block. 8-bit. We should use the 8-bit. So here that's why we select the S bit. It is 8-bit. So here out of 64-bit, and the B is a 64-bit and S is an 8-bit. It means that out of 64-bit we select the S bit. It means 8-bit. Now the remaining bit will be discarded. After selecting the 8-bit, we apply the XOR. We apply the XOR operation on the first block of plain text. It means it is also the S bit, and we already selected the S bit. Now we apply the XOR operation on the first block of plain text P1, and the previous result generated from the S bit. Now we apply the XOR operation. After applying XOR operation, it generating the C1 block, first block of ciphertext, and also repeating the S bit. S bit, it means 8-bit. Now we are considering the shift register. It means that C1 output is a place the right side of the shift register. It means in shift register we are applying the left shift operation. So in the left shift operation, will discard the 8-bit. So now the 8-bit, now the shift register, the 8-bit will be free. So now the C1, the output C1 will be placed, the output of C1 is placed into the right of the shift register. Again, we apply the encryption. Here the shift register, the size of the shift register is 64. Now again we apply the encryption along with the key on the shift register. After applying encryption, is generating a 64-bit output. Now again we do the same process. Now we will select the 8-bit from the 64-bit and discard the, now select the S bit, 8-bit, select the S bit, it means the 8-bit. Remaining bit will be discarded. After selecting the eight bit, we apply the XOR operation with the second plain text block P2. Now, after applying the XOR operation, it's generating the second C2 S bit. So this is the process. We will do the same process on the CN-1 bit block bit, and repeated this process until the final block will be converted into the CN. So final output will be generated S bit, or is repeated the CN. Now So this is the encryption process of the ciphered breadboard. Now we will do the decryption process. So in decryption process, the same process will be carried out. Only the difference is that instead of decryption, here you can see in the previous all method we have seen the decryption. That means the instead of encryption, we will use the decryption term. So here we will do the same process. That means the first we are considering initialization vector, applying the encryption along with the key, apply the encryption along with the key on the initialization vector. After applying the encryption, it's generating a 64 bit output. Now this 64 bit output, we select the S bit. That means select the 8 bit out of 64 bit, and the remaining bit will be discarded. After that, we apply the XOR operation on the first block of ciphertext, on the first block of ciphertext along with the 8-bit, previous 8-bit. After applying the XOR, it is generating the first block of first S bit, first block P1 S bit. Now same process, the C1, the output of the C1 will be given input. It means the C1, the output of C1 is placed into the right side. Now right side and right side, we apply the latched operation, so the 8 bit will be free. So now again we apply the encryption on the 64 bit shift register along with the key. After applying the decryption, it's generating a 64 bit output, and select the 8 bit, or we can say they select the S bit, and the remaining bit will be discarded, and S bit attribute the 8 bit. Now here select the S bit, it means here we select the most significant bit. It means we select the MSB bit. Now again we apply the XOR operation on a C2 block, C2 S bit, and the previous generated S bit. After applying the XOR, is generating the second S bit between the bit. We will repeat this process until the final block N minus C N minus 1 will be converted into the PN. So this is all about the CFD decryption. So I hope you clear this idea. Thank you.